Hello viewers, my name is Dr. Naveen Palavarapu. I'm Chief Transplant Hepatologist at Apollo Hospitals Hyderabad, India. And this is Dr. Manish Varma, he's the Chief Transplant Surgeon at Apollo Hospitals Hyderabad. Today we are here to discuss more about liver, why we need to look after liver, and what are the symptoms if the liver gets sick, and how and when to approach the doctor with liver problems.
Hello viewers, I'm Dr. Manish Varma. I'm the Chief Liver Transplant Surgeon at Apollo Hospitals Jubilee Hills in Hyderabad. And today we are here to discuss about the relevance of liver and liver transplantation in taking care of the overall health of people. As we all know, 19th April has been designated as the World Liver Day by the World Health Organization. And this has been designated thus with a reason, and that is to spread awareness about liver disease and to spread awareness about how to take care of your liver. So today, myself and Dr. Naveen, we will be discussing a few relevant topics that all of us face in our day-to-day life. And so let's start. So Naveen, so why don't we start with telling our viewers what are the signs of liver disease?
Yeah, so very good question, because the reason we want to start with this is because liver is a silent killer. Okay, now till the liver gets at least 70 to 80% damaged, it does not give any symptoms. Okay, and it's a kind of a blessing in a disguise, we could say, because the liver copes, it regenerates till it is at least 70 to 80% damage, and when it gives away, it doesn't give any time for us, and it the damage becomes irreversible damage, and from there on it's only going to be a downward trend of a slippery path. So if you ask what are the signs and symptoms, really you should not be looking for signs and symptoms. You should get yourself regularly checked before you even get signs and symptoms of any liver disease. But if you do have to talk about any what symptoms do you get, generally people can come with, certainly if it is in the early stages of liver disease, they can just come with lethargy, weakness, tiredness, loss of muscle mass, very non-specific symptoms. Okay, so in the early stages of liver disease. But as the liver disease advances and reaches a stage what we call a cirrhosis, so at that point generally people come with either jaundice, fluid building up in the tummy or swelling in the legs, or getting very confused, drowsy, sleeping in the daytime and getting, you know, woken up in the night, and also having blood vomit, black stools. So these are all the symptoms with which they can present with when they have advanced liver disease.
So you mean to say that I may be having a liver disease and my liver might be getting damaged even without my knowing it at all?
Absolutely, absolutely. As I said, liver is such a beautiful organ that it regenerates. Liver cells can regenerate if they're healthy, and then it starts regenerating. In fact, you just need 20 to 30% of your liver and it itself will regenerate to 100% liver. So that's the beauty of liver. In fact, it's the single largest organ in the body apart from the skin which can regenerate. Unlike brain, liver can regenerate. But as I said, once it reaches a stage of say 70 to 80% damage, it starts reaching a stage of irreversible damage. So basically what happens is it starts with inflammation or swelling of the liver that leads to more scarring. That more scarring leads to what we call cirrhosis. Once we reach the stage of cirrhosis, liver will not come back to a normal stage.
So you have already said that liver is a silent sufferer. It suffers and doesn't even let out a symptom. So the next question that comes in my mind is that how do we make sure that our liver is healthy? Are there things that we can do to prevent getting liver disease?
Absolutely. See, I think the most important thing is let's just understand what are the causes of liver disease so that we can look after liver. Okay. The most common reasons why liver get affected are, I would say, probably three most common reasons. One is the alcohol. As you know, alcohol does damage liver to a significant extent. Along with that, what we're seeing, which is what we call a bigger elephant in the room, is the fatty liver. People are getting more fatter, more obese these days, and particularly the childhood obesity, which is alarmingly growing in the proportion. Almost, you know, one in four or five child is obese. So excess fat in the liver damages the liver in a similar way as alcohol does. and also the viral hepatitis, particularly hepatitis B and C, both of them can cause damage to the liver. So whatever the cause may be, once this inflammation starts, it progresses to cause damage to the liver. So I think it is important to know that we should check ourselves regularly to make sure that we don't have hepatitis. We need to make sure that we have a healthy lifestyle. We're not carrying a diabetic risk or blood pressure, cholesterol problems, which puts at a high risk of developing fatty liver, which progresses to further liver damage. So I think it's important to understand that you look for these risk factors and you minimize these risk factors. Along with this, regularly getting yourself checked. And the tests are very, very simple tests. All you need is just a simple liver function test and also an ultrasound scan, which will tell about how the liver is functioning. Okay. So as I said, liver is a silent killer. Until we check for these things, we would not know. In fact, most of the times when people come to our clinic with hepatitis B or hepatitis C infections, is they get picked up for an annual checkup for another reason, and then they pick up that they got hepatitis B or C. Sometimes, of course, they present, if it is advanced stage, they do present with the complications of liver disease, but most of the times they do present to us with just general regular blood tests.
So that brings us to a very important and interesting point. You spoke about hepatitis B and C. These are preventable, right?
Absolutely.
So,
absolutely.
What are the vaccines available? What are the treatments available? And when should we start?
Yeah, I think it's a very important question to understand, because hepatitis B and C viruses, they go unnoticed. And in fact, what we're seeing now these days is just the people who got detected with hepatitis B is just the tip of the iceberg. And the WHO estimates that out of 10 people who got hepatitis B, only one of them gets picked up. Okay, so there's still so many people who don't even know that they have hepatitis B virus in them. And the WHO also estimates that there are about 10 lakh people who die every year because of hepatitis B. In fact, this virus is more common than HIV, and it's more dreadful than the deaths because of tuberculosis or any other infections. But unfortunately, it doesn't get that much notice in the public, because they think that this virus does not cause significant damage. But let me tell you one thing, that hepatitis B causes liver cancer and liver cirrhosis, and it is estimated that hepatitis B causes 100 times more risk of causing liver cancer compared to a normal population. So it is a virus which sits in our liver, damages, and it can cause serious problems. Yet this is also the virus, if we detect it early, we can prevent from further damage, we can save our lives. And that's why it's important to understand more about this hepatitis. Now, how does it get transmitted? Hepatitis B gets transmitted through three main routes. One is body fluid contact. So if somebody has got hepatitis B, and if you actually give a blood transfusion to another person, they can transmit the virus through the blood transfusion. It also can get transmitted through sexually. And also third important route is a vertical transmission, mother to the baby. Okay, so these are three common routes that we actually see hepatitis B getting transmitted. So the reason why I'm telling you this is, prevention is nothing but opposite of that, is basically making sure that you check yourself for hepatitis B. And if you do have hepatitis B, please do not give any blood transfusion, please do not donate any blood to others. And at the same time, mothers should get themselves a check for hepatitis B, and then check the viruses, and then seek the liver specialist so that we can control the virus so the baby doesn't get infected with hepatitis B. Now, for hepatitis B, there are excellent vaccinations which are available, which can completely cure or prevent the virus, rather. And there are medications which can control this hepatitis B also if you do get infected. But for this, you need to get yourself checked, and you need to see a liver specialist if you do have hepatitis B. For hepatitis C, there are no vaccinations which are available, but there are excellent treatments which are there, which are just simple tablets, once daily tablets for about 3 months, with which we can eradicate the virus completely. And these viruses can be easily detected, which a very simple blood test can detect these viruses, so that there are good treatments available. So I would urge every person in the world should get themselves checked regularly for these viruses, because we can prevent these viruses before it reaches the irreversible stage.
So the science of liver disease, as we have discussed, They are evident when the liver gets damaged to a certain extent. So early liver disease may not have any signs and symptoms, and it becomes very important for all of us to have preventive checks to make sure that our liver is healthy. These checks are simple. They are simple blood tests and ultrasound. And based on these tests, if treatment is required, if a further consultation is required, you should never hesitate and you should reach out to a liver specialist sooner rather than later. Many diseases are preventable. Vaccinations or early detection and cure can prevent liver damage related to viral liver diseases. Now, when we talk about signs of liver disease, we know that it is in a certain degree of advanced stage that we start getting these signs and symptoms. So if suppose, like you said, Dr. Naveen, that people can have swelling in the feet, they can develop swelling in the abdomen, they can have jaundice, and sometimes they get confused, hepatic encephalopathy, that is called in the medical parlance. Sometimes people can have vomiting of blood. And so when somebody has these kind of symptoms, how urgent it is to consult a doctor? And basically, what should a person do if they find that they're having one of these signs and symptoms? Yeah.
So if somebody has noticed any of the symptoms that Dr. Manish has mentioned, you should certainly see a liver specialist. The reason I say that is these symptoms generally don't come unless the liver is very badly damaged or advanced, or we are in advanced stage of the liver disease. So I think it's important that you consult a liver specialist at the earliest, because time is essence for these kind of life-threatening problems. So somebody can bleed to death with blood vomit or passing black stools, and it's like just opening a tap. They can just completely bleed constantly, and they can become very unwell very, very quickly. So it's important that if you see any of these symptoms, like swelling of the tummy, fluid building up, tummy pain, leg swelling, any of these symptoms, blood vomit, you should certainly see a liver specialist at the earliest, because there are medications, there are treatments with which we can optimize the condition, stabilize the liver condition before it becomes a life-threatening problem. The liver is such a beautiful organ, as I keep saying that, because once it starts failing and it becomes irreversible stage, it affects other parts, other systems of the body, like the kidneys can get affected, lungs can get affected, heart, brain. So there, all these organs are connected in a serial fashion. So once the liver gets affected, all the other organs will certainly take a hit. And once you reach a stage of multi-organ failure, the life risk becomes significantly higher. So before we reach the stage, I think it's important that you see a liver specialist so that we can optimize you and get you out of this life-threatening problems.
So as we have just heard from our liver specialist, that liver is a very vital organ. It's an important organ in our body. It's called the powerhouse. So essentially, it is responsible for running the whole body. And a liver disease can affect all the different body's organs to various extents. Now, we would want to know that what are the options? Say somebody has been diagnosed with liver cirrhosis, end-stage liver disease. So how do we approach, like if a patient comes to us, how do we treat those patients? What are the options available for the patient?
Yeah. So as we discussed, the first thing is to understand what the stage of the liver disease is. Once we know that this patient has reached a stage of cirrhosis and started getting complications, that means probably medical treatment may not work in full extent. So there are different scoring systems which are used internationally, which will tell about how sick the liver is. And once it reaches a stage where the medical treatment may not be sufficient for the patients, and we are looking at the life expectancy significantly reduced life expectancy for these patients because of cirrhosis, then we should start thinking about liver transplant. Because ultimately, the ideal treatment for these patients who have a liver failure or liver cirrhosis is liver transplant. Like if you have a part in a car which is broken, which is not working, what would you do? You would replace that part, right, to get a newer part. Similarly, if the liver has come to a stage where it becomes irreversibly damaged, it cannot be replaced or it cannot be recovered rather, then we should be start looking at replacement, and that is what we call a as a liver transplant. So that leads to the further discussion, which I would like Dr. Manish to answer about further about liver transplant. You know, why, when we actually ask for liver transplant, and you know, is it safe operation to perform?
So just like we discussed a little while ago, liver disease can be graded or staged into various levels of severity, and the early stages of this liver disease are treated medically. So we try to keep the patient as stable as possible for as long as possible. However, when a patient's liver deteriorates or gets damaged to an extent where medicines are not effective, or we do not foresee that the patient will be having a significant amount of healthy and good quality life without a transplant, then we advise the patients for a transplant. Now, liver transplant is a major operation wherein the damaged liver is completely removed and a new liver, either whole or a part of the liver, is put into the patient. Now, this new liver starts working, and it replaces the function of the old liver, and since this is a non-damaged healthy liver, the liver functions become normal, and the patients are able to lead a healthy life. Now, there are a lot of misconceptions regarding the liver transplant, and one of the major ones is that it may not be a very successful operation. Well, this was true maybe around 30 years ago, but now things have changed to a big extent, and liver transplant has become a very successful operation. Just to give you an example, based on our experience at Apollo Hospitals in Hyderabad, Jubilee Hills, we have seen that 95% of our patients who would undergo a transplant would have a successful outcome, and they would get back to their houses after a successful surgery. Now, these patients will have to be on medicines for their lifetime. And we also know now, we have been doing transplants in our hospital for over 10 years now. So we have long-term survival data on these patients, and we know that even after 10 years, 85% of these patients who underwent a transplant are still healthy and leading normal lives. So it is definitely a very, very successful operation. It's a major one, but successful nonetheless.
Yeah, so as we just heard, it is a very safe operation, liver transplant, and it is not suggested, it is not offered to everybody who's got cirrhosis, but of course when they reach a stage where we think that the liver disease will not recover and his life expectancy will be significantly reduced, so those are the patients we suggest to go for liver transplant. There are international standardized protocols that we follow in our hospital to make sure that that's the right treatment for the patient. Now, what are the different types of liver transplant which are available?
So basically, based on the most important thing for a liver transplant is the availability of a donor organ. So based on where we get the organ from, liver transplants can be divided into two basic types. One is the deceased donor or the cadaveric organ liver transplant, and the other one is the living donor liver transplant. In the deceased donor liver transplant, we get organs from brain dead people. These are not very frequently available, and therefore there is a waiting list for the recipients, and many of the patients who are on the waiting list, they cannot wait for that long, and they end up losing their life with some complications that they have while on the wait list. The other option is to do a living donor liver transplant, where one of the family members, a close relative of the patient, would donate a part of the liver. Now, the one thing that has to be done very importantly, and it has to be done in a very, very careful manner, is that we have to ensure that the donor is absolutely safe. So we do a lot of tests on the donor to find out if the donor is fit to undergo a major operation safely. And then we also do tests to assess the quality of the liver and the size of the liver, and whether, and based on all these considerations, we decide whether a person can donate a part of the liver or not. When such a kind of transplant happens, this is called a living donor transplant. The advantages of this transplant being that the waiting time for the recipient is minimum in this, and they can undergo a timely transplant. It's also important for all of us to understand that any disease, if treated in time, can be treated successfully. If we delay treatment, then obviously the outcomes will be inferior, the recovery time of the patients will be more, and many of these patients will not have the desired outcome which all of us want whenever we go forward to treat a patient.
So you just mentioned that liver transplant is a very successful operation and it is a very safe operation, but is everyone fit enough to undergo a liver transplant?
Yeah, that's a very important question, and it's not like everyone who has cirrhosis will be fit enough to undergo a transplant. And to make sure that the transplant, the patient is fit and we carry out the transplant successfully, we do a host of investigations, and those investigations together is called the pre-transplant evaluation. So all the patients with liver cirrhosis who have been advised a transplant will have to go through this process of liver transplant evaluation, and based on this we assess what is the risk of the patient to undergo a transplant. Sometimes we come across patients who have got heart disease and we have to come up with novel solutions for this. So I would just take this opportunity to highlight a few cases that we had done. We got a child with a very rare syndrome which is called Alagille syndrome, and this child had got a heart defect wherein one of the heart blood vessels was completely narrowed down, and the liver obviously had cirrhosis, and this was a 3.5-4 year old child. It was not safe for us to carry out the transplant without taking care of the heart. Now, taking care of the heart with a bad liver means that after the heart surgery, again, recovery would have been a problem and the child may not have survived. So what we ended up doing was doing both the surgeries together in the same sitting. So we had our cardiac surgeons repair the heart defect first through an open heart surgery, and then we did a living donor transplant wherein the mother donated a part of her liver, and we had a successful outcome with this child. This is a very rare surgery which we had done. However, it was done successfully just because we were able to assess the patient properly and we had a good team to take care of the entire thing. Similarly, we have done patients wherein patients had heart problems like coronary artery disease, and we had to do a heart bypass and liver transplant at the same sitting, again successfully. Sometimes we also have to do more complex things like blood group mismatch transplant, especially in present times when the cadavers are running short because of the pandemic, donations are less, and the patients cannot wait forever. So we have done transplants where the blood group is also mismatched, and we have had special treatments, we had to do special, give special medicines and procedures to make sure that a mismatched organ was accepted by the body. So a lot of complex situations are there. However, it is not like we cannot deal with them, and majority of the patients who need a transplant will undergo a successful transplant because of the expert team members which are available here, a multidisciplinary approach to patient care, and excellent teamwork.
So you just mentioned that liver transplant is very successfully done in adults, but is it safe to do in children as well?
Yeah, so transplant can be done safely in children. In fact, many of the childhood disorders will require transplant as early as within a few weeks of birth. We at our hospital routinely do transplants for babies who are small, who are less than 5 kilos of weight, and we have done them successfully with over 90% success results. So transplant is not only possible, but it is many a times essential for the child to have a long life. There are a lot of misconceptions regarding how long the children will live after transplant, whether the liver will last long. And then here, for all our viewers, I would like to clarify that these children are expected to grow normally, go to normal schools, have normal jobs, get married, have families, and lead a normal productive life. This transplant is done in order to enable them to lead a normal life. It's not like we do a transplant to make them more handicapped. So you have to understand, all of us, we have to understand that whenever a transplant is advised, we have to give a serious thought to it, because it is being done for the patients to become active and healthy.
So viewers, as we heard just now from both of us, that liver is a very important organ. It does a lot of functions. It is the biggest chemical factor in the body, and it is important. It's responsible for all of us to look after our liver. And I think this April 19 being the World Liver Day, we should take this opportunity to make ourselves aware of the liver and look after it, because there's nothing better than prevention. Prevention is better than cure, as you know. And I think it's important that we understand the liver, when it can get sick, how it can get sick, and who to approach if it gets sick, and what are the treatment options we have, and how to safeguard our liver. And certainly don't forget about the vaccinations, the hepatitis B vaccination, which certainly will prevent you from getting any of these deadly viruses, which, as I said earlier, are much more dangerous than the HIV, AIDS, and the tuberculosis. So make sure that you get yourself checked for hepatitis B and C viruses. Get your scan, ultrasound scan, regularly, so that we make sure that there is no damage happening to the liver. And if there is damage, do not hesitate and contact the liver specialist, so that we can prevent, or we can minimize the further damage that is happening to the liver. But if the damage unfortunately still happens, or patient presents late, then there are excellent treatments available, including a liver transplant, which is a very safe and successful operation in this day and age. And so do not hesitate to get yourself checked and get yourself treated if there are any problems.
One important message for all our viewers is that, just like me and Naveen, we are giving you this information as a team. We also take care of the patients as a team. So whether the treatment, whether the liver disease requires medical treatment, or it is advanced to an extent where it would require surgery in the form of liver transplant, we are there to take care of your liver health, and you can come to us. We will be assessing your liver condition, and we can make sure that you lead a happy life, which is free of any kind of liver disease. The theme for the World Liver Day this year is to keep your liver healthy and disease free. And we are there to help you with this goal. So thanks a lot for watching. Stay safe. Keep your liver healthy and disease free.
Thank you.